Your next stop.
Back Asswards Weird World. Hello, and thanks for tuning in again to your Back Asswards Weird World. Man, I am on a Parasite trip. Specifically, the plague of the worm. And I am not kidding about this. I do believe it is real. It is serious. And it is now. And it's happening now. Right in front of your face. And no one even realizes it. I found the coolest channel on YouTube. I don't know how I came across this channel. I'm kind of surprised that these videos are here for me to see on YouTube early. But found this channel on YouTube. And these videos are from 12 years ago. And the guy that made this, the channel that made this is spot freaking on from 12 years ago. The name of the channel is Skizzit Gesture, and I'll put the link to his channel in the pinned comment below. And man, this is, the information is just right on. Guy hasn't made videos for, looks like, 5 or 6 years, and these videos are, like I said, what you're going to see here in my video is a compilation of some of his work here. I'd love to just share it all, but, you know, I can't, you know, obviously just steal the dude's work, but I wanted to give you guys a good teaser of what he's got on his channel, and would advise you to go over there and look at his work. It is good. While these clips of his are playing here, I'm going to also be playing an audio interview off of another YouTube channel, and that channel would be Fraser Kane. He's an astronomy reporter, but he's actually doing an interview on multicellular life with a Dr. William Ratcliffe. And although these two things may not seem related, when I listened to the interview with this guy, it just seemed to tie right in. So I figured I'd share what he was saying here with the information you're going to see. Check it out.
We are excited by multicellularity because of the complexity of the organisms that have evolved, by the opportunities this creates for novel ecologies, and by the way in which these new kinds of organisms have changed our planet, right? Like, this is a global changing phenomenon.
So just to understand, yeah. So like, when you have the anaerobic yeast that are going, yep, purely through fermentation, and you're finding they're changing their structure to hold, mm-hmm, on to each other. Mm-hmm. Is there any kind of differentiation in their shape, in the way that they're, you know, someone is using their left hand to hold on with their right hand, or are they perfectly interlocking system that is, I don't know, like, you've seen patterns where they just happen to all lock together, but it's the same shape again and again and again?
Yeah, it's more the latter. It's not quite as crystalline as you might expect. It's more stochastic, right? So it's, yeah, more like, if you imagine what fibers look like when you're zoomed in on a piece of paper or something, where you have a bunch of interweaving, you know, pieces. It's more like that, right? Not right. Quite M.C. Escher, right? You know, perfect tiling or something.
Yeah.
But right, so we don't really have stereoscopic integration or anything like that. But in the anaerobic lines that evolved to be large, what we did was, every 200 days of evolution, so from 0 days all the way up to 1,000, we pulled out an isolate, so they're one clonal genotype for each time point. And then we grew those up and we stripped them down to single cells in a really slick procedure where we can basically digest away the cell wall, get single cells. And then we can sequence the gene expression of each one of those cells. It's a really cool technique. It's very, very cutting edge. Everyone's proposing it in their grants and stuff these days because it's really powerful. You know, gene expression analysis has been around for a long time, but now you can do it at the single cell level. That allows you to see information about heterogeneity and division of labor that you couldn't see if you just took a whole organism, mushed them up, and asked what genes are being expressed. And when we do this, we see that they start out with really just one cell state, which is a growing cell state. And over time, they actually evolve three cell states that are very distinct in their gene expression. we always have the growing cell state. And in some sense, what we think is happening that is that these guys are kind of almost like the stem cells. They do the division, and then some of those cells that they make turn into different kinds of cells. And then we have a cell state that is expressed primarily, so I have to be a little careful because this is all work in progress, and this sure. is stuff that you know has not been published yet, but is I'm pretty confident about. The gene expression analysis is done and it looks really good. So I'm very confident in that. But exactly labeling which cells are doing what and why they're doing it, that's what we're working on right now. So with those caveats aside, I'll tell you what I think is happening. So we have a subset of the cells that are actually expressing a lot more cell wall material. These cells, if you look at the genes that they're turning up, these specific cell wall biogenesis genes, and you label those products that they're making, you see that it's the hub. So we have sort of this network of cells, and that means that you have hub cells and have a bunch of branches attached to them, and you know they're highly connected. And they have these big branches of cells that are sort of tugging on them. And our biophysical models, we've done some really nice 3D biophysical models with Peter Juncker at Georgia Tech. They suggest that's often where the breakage occurs in our groups. So if you want to make the groups stronger and bigger, you should reinforce those specific hub cells and make them stronger. And what we're seeing is all of these guys downstream, they're cranking up cell wall biogenesis, and it's being expressed in a subset of those cells, the ones that need it, that are at that hub. So that's pretty cool because you're kind of seeing this biophysical differentiation.
And so is that sort of similar, like epigenetic, like like you've got the cell realizes the conditions that it's in and expresses different genes depending exactly. on its situation, whether it's at that's the outside or whether it's yep. one of the structural components.
Right. And so there's different ways in which you could get there as a cell. We don't know what the regulation is. They do all sorts of things on a clock. And so there may just be its internal clock ticker, right? That's just, and so we can, what we're doing right now is we're actually turning these things that evolved to be multicellular. We're genetically engineering them. It's a pretty cool, pretty powerful technique.
And so how, I mean, I guess, yeah. you know, when I think about animals like me, you know, I've got hair cells, I've got skin cells, I've got, you know, liver cells, et cetera. And right, you've got this differentiation that is just continued and continued and continued. And so is the hope that you're starting to see the beginnings of this differentiation in your yeast. And if you run the experiment forward, you will get to some point where it's clearly making outer membranes, inner structural elements, et cetera.
That's exactly right. Yeah, we don't. So one of the neat things about what we're doing is it's exploration. Like I do not know what's going to happen. And if I had hypotheses, they're only as good as my prior knowledge. I mean, that's actually one of the things that is wonderful about our approach is that in some sense it's hypothesis-driven science, but in another sense it's not. It's exploration. And hypotheses are great for finding mechanism, for trying to get at the sort of nitty-gritty of why something does something else. But if you're in a space where you don't understand it very well, hypotheses can be a crutch because you can only hypothesize what you already understand, or you at least think you understand. And so exploration is slightly different. You know, we are prospectively exploring how complexity arises in real time, which will allow us to generate additional hypotheses that we can rigorously test. But there's so much that we don't know about multicellularity that we are, I think, better served by doing exploration rather than taking what we already know and, you know, trying to see if it's, you know, rigorously test those hypotheses in model systems or mathematical models.
It must be exciting to see these kinds of things starting to develop, but also frustrating in that it still takes so long. You wish you could just go forward. You know, you've been doing it for whatever, 12 years, you know, imagine another 20 years, where would we be? But every day you have to come in and you have to feed the yeast and you have to collect the survivors and you got to go, there's all
right. And even once you have this super exciting result, it's usually 2 to 5 years before you can publish it because you have to just make an iron, you have to really understand
right.
it, right? So we try to do a really holistic style of science where we do the evolution, we do the genetics to identify the things that have changed. We use the genetics to identify genetic mechanism. We integrate this with fundamental biophysics because you cannot understand multicellularity without understanding its biophysical context. It's so deeply embedded to how and why multicellularity evolves. And we try and integrate all this with broader mathematical models that try and extrapolate this beyond a simple laboratory model system. So our papers are they're multi-year efforts from a team from a big team of scientists with different skills. And that's really rewarding because you can write, you can do the kind of science that I frankly always wanted to do. But it's only made possible by, you know, by strong funding, by long grants. You know, 5-year grants are really nice, by being able to have people that are willing to invest 5 years in a project and just really go after it day after day and, you know, tie up every loose end. And while at the same time, cool new stuff is coming down the pipe. And you're like, oh, I want to work on the shiny new thing. But no, we got to get the old stuff out.
Right. Don't forget about the yeast. Feed the yeast.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. It is interesting that there's this division in the astronomical fields, and, you know, I'm sure it's the same in yours, that there's the theorists and then there are the experimenters. And I tend to favor the experimenters just because there's something just so joyful about just going out. As you say, it's exploration. You kind of go out into the unknown. You don't know what you're going to find. What'll happen if we just keep feeding yeast and keep collecting the heaviest ones and just let that run for tens of thousands of generations? Let's find out.
And already it's changed our priors.
Yeah.
Like, considerably. So when I started this out, nobody was doing experimental evolution and multicellularity. It was frankly sort of a ludicrous idea because the thinking was, well, you're never going to make an animal. It's too hard. It takes too many steps. We don't even know what to start with and how to select for it. And, you know, the thinking was that multicellularity was rare and very difficult. Mm-hmm. And that, in fact, we can get into this, but there's this general thinking in biology and probably in astronomy as well, the things that are rare indicates that they're difficult. And in biology, that's not always the case.
Yeah.
You can have things that are rare because they came first and filled the niche and suppressed further innovation into that space. Or you can have, you know what I mean? And so you can have things that are common, even though they're extraordinarily difficult, because there's an advantage and evolution has many high dimensional ways of getting to different places, to the same place, given, you know, many generations of selection. You know, we're primarily coming from an evolution stance. Like I was trained in EEB, but in astrobiology, I think it's really helpful to try to figure out what's the probability of this? What are the big constraints? Are there certain geochemical conditions under which this is favored? For example, you know, is how important is oxygen? Is no oxygen a death knell? Is high oxygen necessary? Those are all really open questions, and they're very difficult to answer for anything outside of Earth. And so we can do some stuff here. So cellular life, in some sense, the hardest challenges in all of biology are getting a bacteria or an archaea, getting a cell, right? Like coupling
the abiogenesis in the first place.
That's hard. Like, I think it's in some sense, the fact that it happened so fast, the fact that, like, you know, I actually think that Eric Smith and what's his name? He was just on Mindscape, gave a great interview. So there's biochemists and chemists that are working on origin of life. I think there's convergence in the field that, you know, what you need is essentially primitive metabolism that's primarily driven by planetary disequilibria, right?
Right.
Primarily, like, you have a giant battery of a planet. If you have a planet with a ferrous core and a water surface, then you're just going to have electrons fluxing from the core into space via UV breaking apart water, and then electrons from oceanic spreading or whatever, like basically going into that oxygen and flying off into space when hydrogen is liberated and fluxed out off the planet. And so you have this, like, just constant electric battery of Earth, which allows for disequilibria to exist. And if those energetic disequilibria can be endogenized and accelerated by chemistry, then you kind of have seeded this planetary incubator for chemical evolution.
Right.
And, you know, the difficult thing is, like, you have the metabolism for free. You get simple carbon chain metabolism, like Fischer-Tropsch reactions occurring on minerals in all sorts of aquatic environments for free. And all you really have to do is get TCA cycle, Krebs cycle, run it backwards, and you can fix carbon and make all the molecules that we ever really need in biology. And you just kind of have to couple that metabolism to a Darwinian mechanism that accelerates it, and then you're off to the races, because, you know, it can happen fast. And I'm actually kind of partial to that argument. So what are the singularities that are difficult with getting to complex life? The big ones are, so cells are huge and difficult, but that apparently happens fast. Once you have that, eukaryotic cells are seemingly important, right? There's no bacterial lineages that have evolved anything remotely complex in the multicellular space. You're talking about chains of cells, or at the very best, these balls of nostoc cyanobacteria that look like those balls you throw in your dryer to keep things from clumping up. Mm-hmm, they're about like about that size. They occur in really cold lakes, but they're just spherical balls of cyanobacteria. They're not that exciting. Eukaryotes, which are these cells that are essentially, you know, they have the symbiosis with JVM mitochondria. Actually, don't personally think the mitochondria is game-changing in that many ways, but what eukaryotes have that is game-changing is a really complex architecture to the cell. They have a lot of flexibility and dynamicism in the way the cell can move. They have actin cytoskeletal networks. They have all this subcellular compartmentalization. And it's relatively easy for, there's a lot of possible states that a eukaryotic cell can exist in. They can be an amoeba, they can be flagellated, they can be hard. I mean, they can do everything. All the different kinds of cellular differentiation you see in plants and animals, like the eukaryote could probably do some version of that, right? Like these things aren't really new, they're just repurposed.
Right.
So eukaryotic cells have all this behavioral repertoire that prokaryotes just don't really have. Prokaryotes are primarily super crazy and complex across lineages, but eukaryotes, a single genotype can be complex, right? And so that's the main advantage that eukaryotes have. Eukaryogenesis just happened once. It's probably pretty hard to do, in my opinion. It took a while and it required a pretty wholesale reworking of the way in which these cells work. You have to have a nucleus, you have to have all these other compartments. That's hard. And so, and that took a long time. So that's one sort of singularity that's a bottleneck. The next one is animals. Like, we don't think of plants as being intelligent, right? You can have all the cool macroalgae, kelps, plants, Volvox, you know, there's really cool algae out there from a multicellularity perspective, but they're not going to be making radio antennas. You need something which is a heterotroph, which can have, you know, cognition, neural networks, brains, right? So first of all, you need to evolve something like animals. Animals are their own singularity. The holozoans, so animals, we call them the metazoans. That's the clade that is synonymous with animals. And the holozoans are like kind of one hierarchical level higher, and those include these other quasi-single-celled, quasi-multicelled oceanic critters, philisterians, ichthyosporians, coanoflagellates, and they have all these really interesting cellular behaviors that you see in animals. And in fact, almost all the genes that we have for multicellular development, these things that aren't animals, they have them. They use them for different things. Animals seem to have just repurposed them for multicellularity. But animals only evolved once, and to some extent, the conditions were probably, you know, had to be kind of right for that to happen. You probably needed a fair amount of oxygen, right? Especially for things like bilaterians. We don't think about this, but non-bilaterian animals really just have one or two cell layers thick. Jellyfish are like one cell layer thick with jelly on the inside. Bilaterians have multiple cell layers thick, and you're probably not going to get that without oxygen and without circulatory systems and oxygen carriers. Static oxygen binding molecules like globins, and then mobile globins especially that you can move around. Once you have gills, you can get really big, right? Because you can decouple size from diffusion. And that's hard. Getting animals is hard. Getting animals probably require the right genetic composition of the unicellular ancestor. Like, you probably aren't going to get animals. You're not going to get animals from an algae. You're not going to get animals from a fungus, even though fungi are actually fairly closely related to animals. You need something with like holozoan-like behavior, where you have cells that can be amoeba, cells that can have flagella, things that are already heterotrophic and are not relying on photosynthesis for generating energy. Because if you do that, you're not going to make an animal. You're going to make something which looks like a plant. You need to set the stage for something which has the genetic repertoire of animals, but is not yet an animal. And how hard is that? I don't know. Once you have animals, it's not just enough to have a jellyfish. You need animals with brains. You need animals with neurons. Neurons, interestingly, evolve twice, we think, within animals, once in comb jellies and once in mussels too, and once within the cnidarians and bilaterians, which is kind of astonishing, honestly, that like comb jellies, right? These things which have like luminescent patterns as they wave their cilia. They have different genes for neural transmission and mussels. And if you like use any of the neurosystem modulating drugs that we have, like that work on all animals, doesn't work on them because they're not using the same genes. It's really cool.
That's amazing. So I had no idea.
So once you have an animal, basic animal, it's probably not that hard to make a neuron. In fact, we have it convergently evolving, right? So, and neurons are just bootstrapped up bioelectric cells. All cells can communicate with other cells bioelectrically. Every cell uses an electron gradient to generate energy. And so being able to tweak other cells' electron gradients is pretty easy with, you know, membrane-bound proteins that can be dynamically regulated based on voltage. And so basically the building blocks for cells to communicate bioelectrically is just embedded in the system of how cells work. And neurons are just super specialized versions of regular cells, right? And so then once you have a nervous system, how difficult is it to evolve a brain and have intelligence, right? Intelligence in the sense of being able to, you know, within generation, plastically fit your environment and do all sorts of complicated things. That's pretty hard too. Although brains appear to have evolved once in bioelectricians, but big brains evolved twice or so multiple times within mammals even, but also you see like octopi and squid evolving big brains pretty independently of the rest of animals. Like, you know, they're sharing a common recent ancestor with a mollusk, with a clam. And so, you know, an octopus brain, it's a pretty remarkable achievement for a clam. So I actually think that that's possible to do, but, you know, which is what you need if you're going to generate the resources required to have technology. Having us evolve that in a social context, allowing for communication, once you have communication and societal level scales of stores of information being preserved, you can have the kinds of technological development that you could detect across the universe. But there's a whole lot of singularities baked into the story I just told you, and really not any of them rely on multicellularity other than in the sort of most proximate sense.
Right. And if you had to pick one of those, would it be eukaryote?
As the most difficult?
Yeah.
I'd say animal. So if animal. I had to pick, I'd say animal.
Yeah. So a sort of Swiss Army knife of a cell seems possible.
Yes.
A single cell, but that's really under a lot of evolutionary pressure to figure out how to be able to be adaptable in a lot of places. But for them to come together and differentiate and form an animal feels like a pretty big jump.
I think mobile heterotrophy with muscular motility dictated by a nervous system can you know, like that type of behavior, it's maybe not the biggest jump, but it just seems so dependent on having the right system, having the right cell biology, and having the right earth scale situation where you need the unicellular ancestor with that repertoire of behaviors. I think you do need actually a lot of oxygen to get something which is animal-like, because it's heterotrophic. It's going to be burning a lot of O2. Because it's big, it's going to need fairly high O2. Eukaryogenesis, to me, I think there's more opportunities for that. You can chill in a deep sea hydrothermal vent and be kind of ignorant of what the rest of the world is doing and become a eukaryote. Like, that's kind of what we think has happened, right? Like,
right.
The things that are not eukaryotes but are the most eukaryote-like are these Asgard archaea, named after the Norse gods, and the Loki archaeota and the Heimdall archaeota, which are fun to say, are these archaea which are found in these, you know, deep sea hydrothermal vents, that they are very much archaea. They don't have mitochondria, but they have all these genes that we thought once were only found in eukaryotes. They have complex cells. They're interacting with bacteria symbiotically in their environment in ways that like really looks like a precursor to domesticating mitochondria. They're doing chemical metabolism with like bacteria, and they have these long elongated arms that they're interacting with them. It's one of the coolest discoveries in the last 5 years, honestly, in my opinion.
You know, you're doing an experiment to essentially to try to make a yeast into a eukaryote.
Well, they're already a eukaryote.
More differentiate then. You know, do you... I mean, is the goal to make that transition to animal, or can you envision a different experiment, same thing, thousands of generations, to try to go from pre-animal to animal?
Yeah, we are not going to get animals because they have a fundamentally different ecology. Our guys aren't motile. They're not really tracking down prey, like that kind of thing. What I want to see, I'll answer the second question next, but what I want to see with our system is like, I think snowflakes are their own thing. They're their own organism, and they're going to evolve bodies and division of labor. I didn't even tell you about the third kind of cell type, but it doesn't matter. But they're going to evolve bodies and division of labor in ways that make sense for them based on their mode of growth, based on the selection that we're applying to them, right? Like based on the toolkit that's available from their unicellular ancestor, which is broadly speaking, that's true for every single thing involving multicellularity. That's the way in which it works. And so, you know, I want to see how far we can push them. We're already getting to the point where reverting them to unicellularity genetically is very difficult, if not impossible. I want to get to the point where, you know, I would like to know if at a certain point, if we break them back to unicells, do they die? Are they like animals in that sense that like single cells just perish? They're not able to persist. How much developmental innovation can we get? How complicated and how organized and how precise and how robust can their bodies become, right? How many different cell types can we get? How much transcriptional regulation can we see? Like, these are all really open questions that I'm delighted they're evolving as quickly as they are, frankly. Like, I know it's slow, but it's actually faster than I expected. Like, didn't expect to see cell type differentiation so soon, and yet I think it's unambiguously happening. So the second question is, how could we get something more like animals? And I think what you want to do there is take something which is basically from that holozoan group. So in fact, we started a project doing this and COVID killed it, sadly.
Oh.
So yeah, you want to take like a quinoflagellate. Nicole King is, you know, one of the world leaders, I'd say the world leader in quinoflagellate animal relation multicellularity. Quinoflagellates are these cool creatures that live in the ocean. They share a common ancestor with animals like 1.1 billion years ago. They look like a sponge. In fact, the individual cells in a quinoflagellate are almost identical physiologically to the cells in a sponge. They have a little collar, they have a flagella, they whip the water around them, they suck the water through, it gets caught on that collar, which has mucus on it, and they eat bacteria that are being filtered through them. So they're basically doing at the single cell level or at the small multicellular group level what a sponge is extremely good at doing, pulling water through it and filtering out the bacteria and eating it. So Kai Tong, this great PhD student in my lab, started an experimental evolution project with quinoflagellates where we were basically evolving them in two different ways, size selection, like our snowflake yeast. What happens if we pull on the lever to get bigger? How do they do it? Can they, you know, what happens? And then also when we're trying to make them adhere to a substrate and become more sponge-like. So, you know, sticking like a little blob, sticking to a glass slide and filtering water through them. And then Kai went back to China and fall of 2019 to December of 2019 to renew his visa, and COVID hit and he was locked out of the country for a year and a half.
Yeah.
And it destroyed that project.
But that's so, how you would go about it, you think?
I would either use quinoflagellates, or there's another researcher in Switzerland, Omaya Duden, who works with a different holozoan, the ichthyosporians. And he actually has a system which has proto-embryos. Like, it forms a sphere and it has like polarity, and then it just like sporulates and makes, so it forms a sphere of cells that has polarity and it looks like an embryo, but then it just explodes with a whole bunch of spores. So it looks like an animal embryo until it explodes with spores. It's really, really, really cool. And he's really keen on doing some experimental evolution as well. And I think we're going to collaborate on that project as well.
It's interesting. I mean, it seems like going after what appear to be the rate limiting steps and then mm-hmm. trying to force the evolution in the lab will give a lot of information about how difficult it might actually be. Yeah. Okay, so I want to talk about this idea of a shadow biosphere. And this has been proposed by many people, that there are life forms that, you know, that are existing within our environment, but we don't have we're not looking for them, and so we just never notice them. Do you think there's any possibility of a shadow biosphere?
Can you tell me more? I have my own thoughts on this, but I want to get a little more insight on what you're thinking.
Well, I don't think anything. I think that, I mean, it doesn't seem, I mean, me personally, you know, you know, my job is to ask the questions. My opinion mm-hmm. is that we all use the same matter, energy, and mm-hmm. there would be waste produced in certain ways that would be mm-hmm. obvious, and we wouldn't know where that came from. When you think about a seabird colony that's, you know, there's tons and tons of bird mm-hmm. poop everywhere. Where did mm-hmm. the bird poop come from? We would see giant deposits of...
It's like a dark matter question.
Yeah, we would see giant deposits of stuff and go, where did that come from? There's no biological process that's doing it, and yet it just keeps appearing out of nowhere. Must be the shadow biosphere. And so I think that, I think if there was enough out there, then we would see the evidence, macro evidence that would be obvious mm-hmm. and begin the place for search. That's my feeling.
So I got two thoughts on this. And one is very real and one is currently sci-fi. All right, so the very real one is that there is a shadow biosphere of a sort, in that we do see it if we look for it, but we typically haven't looked very much. And that is the deep Earth biosphere. Basically, no matter how far down you go in Earth, you pull samples, you find living things. Mm-hmm. It's ridiculous. You find them inside rock. You can dig up mud that has been in the seafloor for a million years and separated from the surface. And it's full of living bacteria, and they have highly reduced genomes. And it looks like they've just been circling the same carbon over and over and over, just fragmenting their genomes until they become highly specialized on different, you know, smaller and smaller pools of food that's available.
Right.
You know, you go.
They're all sharing the same carbon atom, just with a little bit of heat.
And they have, like, you know, you can estimate their doubling time, and it's like 10,000 years.
That's amazing.
It's ridiculous, right? You go down to, you know, gold mines a mile deep, you tap the water, and there's like a single species of bacteria that's eating hydrogen that's being created by radioactive decay. And like, that's really cool. Like it basically means that outside of like the sun absorb, you know, essentially turning us into Venus, like there's no way to sterilize this planet.
But we share a common ancestor with that.
We do.
Right. Yep. So something that we don't share a common ancestor that is still existent on the Earth.
Okay. That's I don't know of any evidence for that, but here's the sci-fi thing. And what made me really think about this seriously for the first time was a paper 2-3 years ago where somebody made a mirror image DNA synthase. And so basically it copies DNA, but it makes a copy that has the opposite chirality of standard DNA. So the really interesting thing about this is that all the enzymes that work on modern DNA, standard DNA, it doesn't work on it, right? You can take this stuff, you can put it in pond water for a month. They did this and it's completely intact after a month. Whereas you take regular DNA and it's gone in like an hour because everything wants to eat it.
Yeah.
And I could be wrong. I'm not a biochemist, but if I think, but the thing that got me thinking about this as this could be a phase transition where humans inexorably change the way in which life on Earth works, like forever, is if you were to make a mirror image ribosome and a mirror image cell where everything was the opposite chirality, you could make something which basically wasn't an ecological competition, really, maybe for like metals or something, but it wasn't really an ecological competition with the standard biosphere, wasn't impacted by toxins from the standard biosphere. There's a fair amount of automatic chiral switching that just happens spontaneously, spontaneous racemization. So there's kind of crumbs. I think there's crumbs on the, you know, crumbs up from the feast of the standard biosphere that something which was mirror world biosphere could actually consume. And so if somebody were to make a mirror world pelagibacter or a mirror world, you know, whatever environmental bug and release it, it seems plausible to me that you'd have something which would then have a completely open ecological niche where there's all these little metabolic crumbs trickling down through spontaneous racemization from this huge biosphere, and they can essentially evolve and occupy different niches with very little competition. Viruses wouldn't impact them, right? Antibiotics wouldn't impact them. You know, they'd be competing for space, they'd be competing for light, they'd be competing for metals, but nothing else. And wouldn't that be a trip? Once you open that bag, I don't think it's ever, you're never going back, right?
Yeah, that's really interesting. That I mean, you know, it's sort of similar to this idea of people talking about like aliens and just like, you know, what if the aliens were so different that we couldn't even comprehend them? And that's absolutely possible, but we share a universe. We share radiation from the stars. We share the various chemistry that exists in our...
That's right.
But if they, for example, were based on opposite chirality life, then there would also be vast swaths that we wouldn't be competing with them about and maybe wouldn't recognize their process and wouldn't be able to detect them. You know, if you were measuring the chemicals in the atmosphere on some exoplanet and you wouldn't be able to detect the outgassing that you would be expecting, then it would sort of throw the whole search into doubt. So it's very fascinating. It's a very fascinating idea.
Isn't it a cool idea? And the proof of principle of making this in the lab, the mirror image DNA synthase and making mirror image DNA. It's like, it's not just sci-fi. Like somebody, this is within the next 100 years, someone could probably do this.
Wow, that's really fascinating.
I mean, a ribosome is much harder than a DNA synthase, but it's not that hard.
Yeah.